Muy buenas tardes a todas y a todos. Rogamos accedan al escenario doña María Luisa Fernández Miguel, presidenta del Colegio de Veterinarios de Santa Cruz de Tenerife, y don Francisco Javier García Rodríguez, rector de la Universidad de La Laguna.
Señora presidenta del Cabildo
de Tenerife,
señor director
de Cabildo de Tenerife,
España, rectores, rectora,
the University of La Laguna,
resto de autoridades,
a government of the University of La Laguna, university authorities, welcome to our Sancto Santorum of the University of La Laguna.
Consagrado al debate, a la reflexión, consagrado a la cultura, al arte, y que hoy acoge con orgullo y con, desde luego, un sentimiento de auténtico placer, pues esta conferencia de la doctora Jane Goodall, ¿no? No solo por la presencia de esta insigne primatóloga,
sino también por el mensaje que nos va a hablar, also to welcome her message.
Creo que en los tiempos que corren,
and I do believe in this day and age, in this world, in the broken world we live, broken by war, injustice,
si algo necesitamos,
the climate crisis, if we need anything, what we need is hope.
Creo que además la esperanza no se fundamenta por sí sola, ¿no?
Cuando
hablamos de esperanza, la esperanza tiene que estar fundada
en el
trabajo cotidiano de
muchas personas, upon the daily work of many people,
para construirla, ¿no?
But building it block by block.
Me decía la vicerrectora de Extensión Universitaria que ayer la propia Jane Goodall comentaba que
the University of La Laguna, she was saying that Jane Goodall has learned from her work with animals is that animals never give up. And I do believe this is a great thing we could learn. We should not give up. We have to work on the daily to build a fairer world, to build a world with more hope. Something we have to build upon knowledge. Here today, we have the rainbow, a painting of a rainbow that joins humanities and science here in the building. So this is the hope that shall be built upon scientific knowledge. And that's why I do believe today we have a wonderful opportunity to listen to Jane Goodall, to work together, to build a future, and also to work on building knowledge and using it for good. So I invite us all to listen to this message of hope, to build this future and build this hope, because I do believe there is hope. Thank you, everyone.
Hola, muy buenas tardes a todas y a todos.
Welcome, everyone.
Para los colegios de veterinarios de Las Palmas de Gran Canaria y de Santa Cruz de Tenerife, que hemos organizado.
So, as the Professional Association of Veterinarian Doctors of Tenerife and Las Palmas de Gran Canaria, it is a great pleasure to listen to the great Jane Goodall. She is a figure we have learned about at university. She is someone we've admired as scientists ourselves. She opened a road for us who decided to dedicate our lives to animals, the animals who live with us in our tiny, fragile world. Goodall is a reference in ethology, especially great apes. She discovered concepts that now are considered as basics, but back when she discovered them, were pioneers. Her investigation was based on observation, based on science, and based on respect for the other, even if those other ones are members of another species. Her work has also been inspiring for those children and women, for those children and women who saw someone in science. She's now 89, but she is still very bright, and she keeps being an example for all. She keeps shining a light on the way we should follow through, because the youth should be the motor, the engine for bringing us forward to the future of our planet and all of us who are here. Before giving the floor to Dr. Goodall, I would like to give thanks to all of us who have collaborated in making it here today. Thank you to the government of the Canary Islands. Thank you to the Galil of Tenerife. Thank you to La Taonilla workers. Thank you to University of La Laguna. Thank you to the Dean of University of La Laguna. Thank you for all the workers who have helped us be here today. Thank you to Dr. Goodall and Shoots and Roots volunteer program. And finally, I would like to thank especially two people who are not only able to dream of this, but also make it work. My friend Alejandro Suárez, who is the president of the Professional Association of the Veterinarians in Doctors in Tenerife, and the director of the Jane Goodall Institute in Spain. So without you, it wouldn't have been possible without you. Thank you very much.
It's been an amazing journey, this life of mine. This planet has filled me with the wonder of all living things, great and small. We cannot ignore this earth that surrounds us, that feeds us, shelters us, replenishes our bodies and our souls, and stretches our imaginations, where animals, plants, air, water, all care for us. We're all interconnected, people, animals, our environment. When nature suffers, we suffer. And when nature flourishes, we all flourish. I do believe in the possibility of a world where we can live in harmony with nature, but only if every one of us does our part to make that world a reality. So that when you look back over your journey, your life, you can truly say, I did make a difference. Thank you for a wonderful welcome. And as you will hear when I'm talking this evening, this is actually my fourth visit to the Canary Isles, but I'll tell you about that when we get to it. I want to first say thank you to everybody who's made this evening possible, for giving me a chance to share my message with you. And not only the people here, but also the Jane Goodall Institute, Fede, and his team, because I wouldn't be here but for them. So I want to go back to the beginning. I find it very strange that wherever I go, the lecture halls are filled up. And wherever I go, people recognize me. They come up to me in airports and they want a selfie or they want a signature. And sometimes they cry, they're moved. So how did this happen? And when it began to happen to me, you know, I was a very, very shy little girl, and then I spent those years in the forest, and I was really uneasy. And the only way I could come to terms with it was to think, there are two different Janes. This one, just me, standing here talking to you. And then there's a kind of icon out there. And that icon was probably created by the National Geographic way back in the early 60s. You know, young blonde girl out in the jungle with the black apes, a sort of romantic picture. And now I have a really hard job keeping up with that icon Jane out there. I have to do my best. I want to go back to the start, and during this time I hope to mention some of the people who've made a big impact on my life, because we all have people who help us along the way. And to start with, my incredible mother. You know, I think parents make a very major impact on a child's life, and it can make all the difference how that child turns out. I had a wonderful and supportive mother. I didn't really know my father when I was growing up because he went off and joined in World War II, and I was just a child. And then my parents got divorced, so I never really knew him properly, although I met him later. But it was my mother. I was actually born loving animals. People keep saying, "What made you love animals so much?" It was in me. I think sometimes that happens. And so my mother supported this love of animals, and that's what made such a difference. When I was 4 years old, we lived in London, so not many animals there. But she took me for a holiday onto a farm in the country, a proper farm, where cows and pigs are out in the fields and the hens are pecking around in the farmyard. And they gave me a job to collect the hens' eggs. So there were, I don't know, I think 4 or 5 of these little hen houses where they slept at night, and around the edge were the nest boxes, and you could go around the edge and lift the lid. So if there was an egg, I put it in my little basket. And then apparently, I don't remember, I began asking everybody, "But where is the hole on the hen where the egg comes out? I couldn't see a hole like that." And nobody told me. What I remember vividly is a hen, she was brown, and she was going into one of these hen houses. And I must have thought, "Ah, she's going to lay an egg." I crawled after her. Well, that was a mistake. She flew out with squawks of fear. And again, in that little 4-year-old mind, I must have thought, well, now no hen will lay an egg here. But I'm now keen to discover for myself this mystery of where an egg comes out. And so I went into an empty hen house and waited and waited and waited. Now remember, I'm only 4. And apparently I was gone 4 whole hours. And the family got desperate. They didn't know where I was. And then finally my mother sees this excited little girl rushing towards her, all excited to tell the story of how a hen lays an egg. And I saw the egg laid, and I don't know who was more excited, me or the hen. Anyway, my mother, instead of scolding me for making everybody scared, sat down to hear this wonderful story. And the reason I tell it, don't you see there the making of a little scientist? Curiosity, asking questions, not getting the right answer, deciding to find out for yourself, making a mistake, not giving up, learning patience. It was all there in a 4-year-old child. And a different kind of mother might have crushed that early curiosity, and I might not be here. So when I was growing up, I was born in 1934. There was no television. There was nature. We had a big garden. And there were books.
So when it was fine, unless I was at school, of course, I was out in the garden. It was my grandmother's house. When it was cold, I was inside reading books. I loved books. During the war, we had to live a very, very simple life. All food and clothes and petrol, everything was rationed. And so we learned to live saving up everything. We never wasted anything. And that's what we all need to do today, because nature will suffer horribly. She is already. But anyway, so for me it was lucky growing up in the war, because it made me understand the value of things. And books, I loved books. We didn't have money for new books. We got them from the library, and my mother got books about animals. And then I found a little second-hand bookshop, and I used to spend Saturday afternoon going around the shelves. And one day I had saved up my pennies of pocket money, and I could just buy this little book. It was a very small edition of Tarzan of the Apes. So I took it home with me. I read it up in my favorite tree. And of course, 10-year-old girls can be very romantic. And I fell passionately in love with this glorious lord of the jungle. And what did Tarzan do? He married the wrong Jane. So, of course, I knew there wasn't a Tarzan. But I was 10 years old when I said to everybody, I'm going to grow up, go to Africa, live with wild animals, and write books about them. No thought of a girl being a scientist at that time. And everybody laughed at me. How will you get there? You cost a lot of money. You don't have money. Africa, we don't know much about it. It's full of dangerous wild animals. And anyway, you're just a girl. Not my mother. She said, Jane, if you really want to do this, you're going to have to work really hard, take advantage of every opportunity, and then if you don't give up, hopefully you find a way. And this is what I tell young people when I'm traveling around the world, particularly those in disadvantaged communities. And I wish Mum was alive to know how many people have written to me to say, Jane, thank you. Because you did it, I know I can do it too. So that was the influence of my mother. When I left school, I did well at school, but whereas all my friends went off to university, we didn't have enough money. I had to get a job. I had a job in London. And then came opportunity, a letter from a school friend whose parents had moved to Kenya and bought a farm. And she invited me for a holiday. Quit my job in London, couldn't save money there. Went home, got a job as a waitress around the corner. Very hard work. And it took about 6 months, I think, to save up enough money for a fare to Africa. It had to be a return fare. And we should have gone from London through the Suez Canal, but there was a war between England and Egypt at that time. So my boat had to go all the way around Africa and up to Mombasa in Kenya. And so my first visit to the Canary Islands was when that ship docked for supplies or fuel or something. And I was able to step ashore on the Canary Islands and spend a few hours before the ship sailed on again. I arrived, stayed with my friend, and then somebody said to me, Jane, if you're interested in animals, you should meet Dr. Lewis Leakey, famous anthropologist, famous paleontologist. And he was another person who made a huge impact on my life. I went to see him. Amazingly, after taking me around the museum, he told me, just last week, my secretary left. I need a secretary. That boring secretarial training in London made me able to fit into that position. Now I'm surrounded by people who can answer all my questions about the African mammals and birds and reptiles and amphibians and insects and plants, because he was director of the Natural History Museum in Nairobi. And I had amazing times. He let me go with him, his wife, and one other young girl on one of their annual expeditions to search for fossils on the Serengeti. And while I was there for 3 months, living in the middle of nowhere, miles from anywhere, Gillian and I were allowed to walk out onto the plains after the hard day's work. And on one evening, we met a rhino. And I said, just keep still. And the rhino was closer than the end of this auditorium. And he ran back and forth with his tail up. And then, fortunately, the wind was blowing from him to us, and he trotted off in the other direction. Another evening, it was a young male lion, fully grown, with tufts of hair on his shoulders. And I think he was curious. He'd never seen two white young women before. And he followed us for at least four times the length of this platform here, which was a bit scary, but it was also very exciting. And I think it was that evening around the campfire that Leakey decided I was the very person he'd been looking for. For 10 years, he told me, to go and study chimpanzees in Tanzania, in a place called Gombe National Park. Well, it took him a year to find money. I mean, I hadn't been to college, and I was a young girl, and girls didn't do that sort of thing. The British authority, because back then it was under British colonial rule, they said, no, we're not taking responsibility. But fortunately, Leakey never gave up. And so finally they said, oh, all right, but she cannot come alone. So who volunteered to come? We had money for 6 months, and that amazing mother of mine said that she would come for four of those 6 months. She wasn't particularly adventurous. She wasn't physically strong, but she welcomed the challenge. And so we arrived on the shores of Gombe National Park, shores of Lake Tanganyika, in 1960. And she was an amazing help to me. First of all, she set up a little clinic. She wasn't a doctor or a nurse. Her brother was a doctor. He'd given us very simple things like bandages and iodine and various simple ways that you could treat sick people. And because my mother spent hours with different people who were sick, fishermen began coming along the shore to be treated by her. And I learned later that she was known as a white witch doctor. The other thing she did for me, for 4 whole months, and remember, I only had 6 months, for 4 of those months, the chimps took one look at me and vanished into the forest. They'd never seen anybody like me. Chimps are very suspicious. And it was my mother, when I got back depressed in the evening, she said, but Jane, you found that peak, and you're learning much more than you realize. You're seeing with your binoculars how they make nests at night, bending the branches over. You're learning about the different calls they make and the foods they eat. You're learning how sometimes a chimp will travel alone, sometimes a group of males hanging out, sometimes a mother and her young, or a couple of females and their young. Sometimes all the members of what we came to understand is a community of about 50. Sometimes nearly all of them came together when a ripe fruit was available. So she said, she cheered me up. And wasn't it sad? She left just 2 weeks before the breakthrough observation. One chimpanzee, I named him David Greybeard, very handsome, he began to lose his fear before the others. And on this one day, it had been raining and I was a bit despondent and cold, and suddenly I see a chimpanzee crouched over a termite mound. And I see a hand reach out and break off grass stems, push them down into the nest, carefully pull it out and bite off the termites hanging on with their jaws. And I saw him reach up and break off a leafy twig. And before he could use that as a tool, he had to remove the leaves and the side branches, modifying, thus making a tool. And up until that point, science believed humans and only humans used and made tools. We were defined as man the tool maker. And so it was that that caught the interest of the National Geographic Society, and they agreed to fund my work after the first 6 months was over. And so I could relax. And then I began to learn about the chimpanzees. Gradually, partly thanks to David being very calm when I came to a group, the others lost their fear. I went through a bad time when they became aggressive, treating me as though I was a carnivore, wanting perhaps, you know, like a leopard or something. But gradually that phase went and they began to tolerate me getting nearer and nearer. I got to know them as individuals, each with his or her own vivid character. David, his best friend Goliath, who I learned was the top ranking or alpha male. And then there was Mike and Humphrey and Mr. McGregor and Mr. Wurzel and all the rest of them. And there was the old female Flo with her big family, the dominant female, and Passion, the infant killer, and Ollie, timid Ollie with a goiter on her neck, and all the rest of them. And it was so wonderful finding out all this. So like us in so many ways. When they communicate, well, when I got up to the platform here, two people embraced and kissed me. That's what the chimps do, exactly the same. If they're begging for food, they reach out a hand. If they're angry and they want somebody to go away, I mean, it's just like us. And when two males are competing for dominance, they stand upright, they swagger from foot to foot, their lips take a furious scowl, they may wave a hand or a branch in the air. Does that remind you of some male human politicians? Yes, I think so. I loved watching mothers and their interactions with their children. There's a long childhood, 5 to 6 years, the child is totally dependent on the mother. And even when the next child is born, when the eldest one is 5 or 6, sometimes 4, the elder one still hangs around mum, is emotionally dependent on the mother. And so bonds between mother and child get stronger, and bonds between brothers and sisters develop and grow stronger too. Even a 10-year-old will hang around with mum, particularly females. And there was one male, when he was fully grown, when a female is sexually receptive, a male will try to lead her off away from all the others to a far part of the range, keep her to himself. We call it a consortship. And this male, fully grown, he was about 25, and he took his mother with him on the consortship. I don't know what the young female thought about it. And so it was pretty shocking, after learning all this, to find out that chimps like us also have a dark and brutal side. They're capable of killing and a kind of primitive war. But they also have, like us, a gentle, a compassionate, loving, true altruistic side. And when I say true altruistic, an individual who is not at all related may adopt an infant whose mother has died and save that child's life, even an adult male. So I'd been with the chimpanzees about 1.5, 2 years. I get a letter from my mentor, Louis Leakey. And he says to me, Jane, I picked you because you had not been to university. I wanted someone whose mind was not cluttered up with the reductionist attitude to animals of science at that time. But now, he said, I want other scientists to take you seriously. So we have no time for an undergraduate degree. I've got you a place in Cambridge University to do a PhD in ethology. Well, I had no idea what ethology was, and I was very nervous when I got to Cambridge. And can you imagine what I felt when those learned professors told me, Jane, you've done everything wrong. You shouldn't have given the chimpanzees names. You should have given them numbers. That's scientific. You can't talk about them having personalities. You can't talk about them having minds capable of solving problems. And you certainly can't talk about them having emotions like happiness, sadness, fear, and so on. Why? Those are unique to us. Well, I'd learned as a child that that was rubbish. It wasn't true. I had a wonderful teacher. That teacher was my dog, Rusty. I'm sure that many of you have had dogs, cats, rabbits, whatever, and you know perfectly well that we're not the only beings with personalities, minds, and emotions. And so, as my first husband, sent out by the Geographic, was filming everything I was learning, and his films began going around the world. And as my detailed observations, my notes, were transcribed and put out as papers, science gradually began to change its attitude. I never confronted them. That's not my way. I just went on talking about, writing about the chimpanzees as they are. So now, thanks to the chimpanzees, who are so like us biologically that we share 98.6% of the composition of DNA with them, and then there's all these behavioral differences too. So thanks to them, the line, the sharp line that science had drawn between us on a pedestal and all the rest of the animals out there, that line was crossed. It was as though David Graybeard and I had reached across that line, and now scientists are studying emotions, personality, and absolutely intelligence in other animals. And we include now ourselves as part of the animal kingdom and not separate from it. I would say that for young people wanting to study animal behavior, particularly animal intelligence, now is the very most exciting time, because we're finding it's not just the apes and the monkeys who are intelligent, it's not just the elephants and the dolphins, but we find that pigs and rats are incredibly intelligent. Birds were thought to have been quite brainless. Now we know that some birds are amazingly intelligent. And we know from this wonderful film, My Octopus Teacher, as well as many, many anecdotes and papers written by people, how intelligent the octopus is. Amazingly intelligent. And yet they're so different from us, with brains along all their eight arms and just a little one in the middle. So, as I say, it's a very exciting time. We're even finding intelligence in insects. I wasn't surprised about the chimps' intelligence. Why? Because way back, I've forgotten the year, but in the 1950s, I think, an Austrian psychologist called Wolfgang Kohler came here to Tenerife, and he had a chimpanzee colony in what's now known as the Yellow House. And he wrote a book called The Mentality of Apes. And from that book, which I had studied and studied, he talks about the different chimpanzee characters. He talks about how different they are, their personality. he talks about the incredible intelligence of one of them, Sultan, and this was counter to the scientific attitude at the time. Just like Darwin, by the way, 100 years ago, he too talked about animal emotions. Anyway, the Yellow House, I was on my third visit to the Canary Islands. I went to see it, and I truly hope that it will be preserved. It needs to be, because this study was absolutely historic. And I'm so glad that his book has been reprinted recently so that more people can see what he learned all that time ago. So anyway, I got my PhD. I went back to Gombe. I built up a little research station. Gombe's a tiny national park. And they were the best days of my life. I could spend hours, days, out in the rainforest, learning about the interrelationship of all the different plants, animals, trees of the rainforest ecosystem, how everything was interrelated, interdependent. And I also felt this strong spiritual connection with the natural world when I was alone in the forest. So why did I leave? Everybody says, but Jane, did you have to leave? No, I didn't. I could have gone on staying there. We still have research going on. I still go back twice a year to visit. We're in our 63rd year of continuous study of one, or now three groups of chimpanzees, which is pretty much of a record. And I left because in 1986, I helped to organize a conference about chimpanzee behavior. By that time, there were six other field study sites in Africa. And I wanted to know how chimpanzee behavior would be the same or how it might differ according to the environment and something which I thought would be culture. Young ones observe their parents so carefully, their mother rather, or their brother or sister. And so I assumed that probably there would be different cultures, which turns out to be true. But at that conference, which was 4 days, we had a session on conditions in captive situations, and it was shocking the way chimpanzees, babies, were taken from their mothers and trained cruelly to perform in circuses or used as pets or some other entertainment. And worst of all, in the medical research labs, our closest relatives in 5-foot by 5-foot cages alone, with nothing to do, just bars all round. And I couldn't sleep for nights after seeing those videos. We also had a session on conservation, and again, shocking. All the different field sites were reporting decreased numbers of chimpanzees, and I learned that forests right across Africa were disappearing. So I didn't make a decision to leave. It was just something that happened. I went to the conference as a scientist. I left as an activist. And first of all, I visited some of the labs and saw some of the chimpanzees who were pets. And it's been a very long fight, but anyway, finally in the US and Europe, anyway, there's no chimpanzees in medical research anymore. Partly because they actually turned out not to be useful. Although in America alone, there were 400. Anyway, they're in sanctuaries now. And second thing I did was get some money, I think it was probably from the Geographic, get some big blown up posters of chimpanzee behavior. That definitely was the Geographic. Got from the different people at the conference different examples of the tools the chimpanzees used in different places. And I managed to get to 6 or 7 of the different study sites. And I learned a lot about the problems facing the chimpanzees, which is the bushmeat trade, that's the commercial hunting of wild animals for food, and in some African countries, chimpanzee meat is a delicacy, and also some body parts are used in witchcraft. But another problem is they're caught in wire snares set for antelopes and pigs by hunters, and although they can break the wire, they can't get the noose off hand or foot. They may lose a hand or foot, or may die of gangrene. But of course, the worst threat to them is the loss of habitat as forests are cleared. And at the same time as I was learning about the plight of the chimps, I was learning about the plight of so many of the African people living in and around chimpanzee habitat, the terrible poverty, the lack of good health and education facilities, the degradation of the land as communities grew, moving out into the forest, risking the contamination of both chimps and human by diseases, because chimps are so like us that we can catch their diseases and they can catch ours. So it was when I flew over the tiny Gombe National Park that this really hit me. In 1960 and 1970, Gombe was part of a great forest belt growing across Africa to the west coast. By the late 1980s, I looked down on a tiny island of forest surrounded by bare hills. There were too many people living there for the land to support. Their land was over-farmed and infertile. They were too poor to buy food anywhere else. They were cutting down the trees because they needed more land to feed their families and because they needed money from charcoal or timber. And that's when it hit me. If we don't find ways for these people to make a living without destroying their environment, we can't save chimpanzees, forests, or anything else. And that was the beginning of our program, Take Care or Takari. And it began with the 12 villages around Gombe. And this wonderful man, George Strunden, who'd been in Tanzania 15 years, he and I chose, well, he chose the team of local Tanzanians who would go. There were 7 of them. And it wasn't a bunch of arrogant white people going into a poor village and saying, well, you've made a mess of things, we're going to help you. No. It was these 7 local people. And they went and listened, and they asked the people, what can we do to help? They first of all wanted more land, because their own land was over-farmed. So introducing ways of restoring fertility without chemicals. Second, they wanted better education. And we worked with the local Tanzanian authorities to improve the schools. They wanted better health. And again, we worked with the local Tanzanian authorities to improve the health, something the Tanzanians should have been doing but weren't. And gradually, as they came to trust us, we could introduce water management programs, scholarships to give girls a chance of secondary education, microfinance so that villagers could choose their own environmentally sustainable small businesses. And so the program has grown. We call it Takari. Started with the 12 villages around Gombe. It's now in 104 villages throughout the range of chimpanzees in Tanzania. And it's also in 6 other African countries, including, it's not necessarily known as Takari, but this working with the villagers is also where JGI Spain is working in Senegal. So this was all costing money, because we also realized that we could use GIS, GPS, and satellite imagery to help with the conservation in these villages. And volunteers from all 104 villages came to be trained how to use iPhones or iTablets to monitor the health of their village forest reserves. And they became very proud. Again, we let them choose what they would monitor, like an illegally cut tree or an animal trap. But on the positive side, if they saw a chimpanzee or a porcupine or something like that. And all of that data is uploaded into the clouds, so it becomes available to everyone. It's transparent. And by this time, I'm already traveling to different countries around the world. And I'm learning more and more about, even back then, and now we're now in the mid-90s, even back then, we were destroying the planet. Even back then, plastic was becoming a nightmare. Back then, industrial farming was in full swing with its pesticides and herbicides, damaging biodiversity horribly, killing the actual soil on which we all depend. Animal industrial farming, these factory farms, not only horribly, horribly cruel, but also incredibly damaging to the environment. Huge areas of land to grow monocultures, lots of fossil fuel to get the grain to be planted in the fields, and then the harvest, the grain to the animals to the slaughter, and the pieces of animals onto plates of people who eat them. And in addition, all these animals, particularly cows, cows belch out of their mouth, and, well, you know what comes out the other end. That's methane gas, and that's a very, very bad greenhouse gas added to all the CO2 that comes from fossil fuels. So, not surprising that young people were becoming depressed. I met them all over, and some of them were angry. Some of them were really depressed. Most of them were just apathetic. Doesn't seem to matter what we do. And I asked them, you know, why do you feel like this? And they said, more or less the same everywhere. You people have harmed our future, and there's nothing we can do about it. Have we harmed the future of our young people? We've actually been stealing it for many, many, many years. We're still stealing it today, the big corporations, people who waste food, people who don't think about the impact on the environment of what they buy, people who don't really think about our footprint on Mother Nature. But I firmly believe, as I told the young people, especially back then, there was a window of time when if we get together and take action, we can slow down climate change. We can slow down loss of biodiversity. We can raise awareness so that more and more people understand the impact that they make in their life. That's when our youth program, Roots and Shoots, was born. 12 high school students in Dar es Salaam, Tanzania, came to me. They were worried about different things. Some of them were concerned poaching in their national parks. Why wasn't the government doing something about it? Corruption, of course. They were worried about street children with no homes. They were worried about illegal dynamite fishing destroying the coral reefs. They were worried, some of them, about the treatment of stray dogs with people throwing stones at them. And they wanted me to do something about it. So I said, well, look, I love Tanzania, but I'm not Tanzanian. You are. Collect your friends who feel like this, and we'll have a meeting. So we had a historic meeting when Roots and Shoots was born. Why Roots and Shoots? Because if you think of your favorite big tree, it probably began from a little seed. And when it began to grow way back, you could pick it up between your thumb and finger, and there'd be little tiny roots going down and a little tiny shoot just beginning to grow up. And you'd think, how frail, how weak. But you know, there is a magic in that seed. It's a life force so powerful that those little roots can work their way between rocks to reach the water, and that little shoot to reach the sun can work through cracks in a brick wall. And eventually the rocks and the walls will be knocked down. That's roots and shoots. The roots and shoots are the roots, the roots reaching down and the shoots reaching up. And it's just, I get quite moved when I think about it, because these young people now are in 70 countries. And we have members from kindergarten through university. Even adults are forming groups, like the staff of a major corporation. And they're introducing their children from different countries to each other. They form roots and shoots groups. So they're learning about different cultures. And we try to get these young people out into nature as best we can. So roots and shoots is very powerful in Spain, thanks to Fede and his team. And I was with a wonderful group of them this morning doing a beach cleanup with Mr. Turtle, Jose, and seeing the amount of microplastics and fishing nets and old broken bottles and plastic toy dolls out there on the sand, seeing the huge amounts of stuff that they collect every day because the tide washes it in. It's so shocking. But how wonderful that little children as young as three, the youngest was three, they're learning how bad this is, and children can teach their parents. So one of the things about roots and shoots, yes, we have campaigns, and Fede was the one who started collecting cell phones, old used cell phones, so you can get the minerals out and like recycling them. But what was I going to say now? Anyway, so we do have campaigns around the world, like collecting cell phones, like campaigns about the use of water, that sort of thing. Tree planting goes on everywhere. But about 8 years ago, I made a little video, and although it's grown considerably since then, 70 countries, remember, let's have a look at that little video, and you get some idea of what's going on around the world.
You are the reason we found us, so thank you, stars. Some people think it's far away, some know it's with them every day.
Hello.
To some it's a feeling in the heart.
I think you're a bit near.
And when you're out there on your own, it's the way back home. Yeah.
I hope you can see why one of my main reasons for hope is the young people today. Young people who choose what they want to do, and because it's a project of their choice, they roll up their sleeves and they take action. And all around the world, as I travel 300 days a year, I meet these young people, I hear about their projects, and some of the early ones, because it began in 91, they're now out in the big wide world, and they hang on to the values that they learned in Roots and Shoots of compassion and respect and honesty. So they are my greatest reason for hope. And my next reason for hope is the human brain. The biggest difference between us and chimpanzees is the explosive development of our intellect. And it's, you know, as I've said, other animals are way, way more intelligent than we used to think. Crows can solve some problems faster than a normal 8-year-old child. The pig in South Africa, you can Google her. Her name is not Picasso, but Pigcasso. And she watched her rescuer. She was going to be turned into bacon. And her paintings are now selling for $5,000. And she's had two exhibitions, one in London and one in Belgium. I'm going to meet her in February. And I have an original Picasso painting, Pigcasso painting. So Google her and look her up, because it's wonderful to watch her working. So although animals are way more intelligent than we thought, we've made a rocket that went up to Mars and a little robot still crawling around taking photographs of the planet. At one time we thought we might live there, but now, of course, we know we can't. People went to the moon when I was a child. That was just, I mean, you wouldn't even think that it was possible, but people have actually walked on the moon. And think of all the amazing things we've done, some of it not so good. AI can be used in a positive way, but sometimes it's very frightening. But the GIS, GPS, satellite imagery is teaching us stuff we never could have learned without it. How is it possible that the most intellectual creature to ever have walked the planet, notice I say intellectual rather than intelligent, how is it possible that we're destroying the planet, our only home? Because it's not intelligent, is it? And I think there's been a disconnect between the clever, clever brain and the human heart, where we have love and compassion. And only when head and heart work in harmony, I think, can we live up to our true human potential and perhaps get together before it's too late. So the human brain, we are beginning. We're beginning to do things like the beach cleanup I mentioned to make a difference on the planet. And we are, scientists are creating all kinds of amazing technology. We went past a lot of windmills today, getting energy from the wind. There are many solar installations, so we get energy from the sun, and some places from the tide, and so eventually we can stop destroying huge areas searching for fossil fuel, and we can stop putting all this CO2 up into the atmosphere. And if we protect our forests, which is tremendously important, both the forests on land and the forests in the sea, the kelp forests and the seagrass, they absorb carbon dioxide. So we are beginning to come to our senses, but we haven't got enough people working on it yet. More and more coming along, and our Roots and Shoots young people who go into science, I know they're going to make a huge difference. And my third reason for hope is the resilience of nature, because places that we've utterly destroyed can, given time and perhaps some help, once again support life. Maybe not quite the same, but a lot better. If you fly over Gombe National Park today, you won't see bare hills. The trees are coming back, and with the trees come the insects, the birds, and the mammals. So it's a very different view from the air than it was in the late 1980s. And we could say the same for many areas around the world. And then animals. Animals on the very brink of extinction can be given another chance. You have the Spanish lynx as one example from here that was virtually extinct. And I went to visit the place where the lynx are being bred in captivity and released into the wild. So at least they now have a chance. And then my next and last, well, I've got many reasons, but the one I'm going to talk about, my last reason for hope, is what I call the indomitable human spirit. People who tackle what seems impossible and won't give up and so often succeed. And when I'm talking about inspirational people, I said earlier, and I've just remembered, I was going to mention all the people who made such an impact on my life, or at least some of them. And there was my mother I mentioned, and Dr. Louis Leakey, who gave me my chance in Gombe. But then there was my dog, Rusty. My goodness, what a difference he made. He was with me all the time. And then there was David Greybeard, who introduced me to the Gombe chimps. And since then, there have been so many people springing up in different places where we start the Jane Goodall Institute or Roots and Shoots, the executive directors like Fede, the staff, the volunteers, all around the world. They're amazingly tackling what seems impossible to begin with, but they're making a difference. And as the young people join Roots and Shoots, it becomes more and more inspiring. There's Nelson Mandela and Martin Luther King, the kind of icons. But then there are people overcoming tremendous physical disabilities. So that's why I have Mr. H. And maybe some of you saw him in that little video. And Mr. H was given to me 32 years ago by a man who thought he was giving me a stuffed chimpanzee for my birthday. Well, as you can see, Mr. H, the man was called Gary Horn. Mr. H has a tail. Therefore, he is not a chimpanzee. But Gary Horn is blind. He went blind when he was 21 in the US Marines in an accident. He decided for some peculiar reason to be a magician. And everybody said, Gary, you can't be a magician if you're blind. Well, the children don't know he's blind when he's done his show. And then he'll say to them, something may go wrong in your life because we never know. But if it does, don't give up. There's always a way forward. He's learned, he's done skydiving. He's done cross-country skiing. He's been down with great white sharks. He says the change in pressure of the water is absolutely magical. I mean, he's in a cage. But he's taught himself to paint. And there's a little book called Blind Artist on Amazon. And he's never seen Mr. H. He's only felt him. And there's this wonderful portrait. So this inspirational spirit, we all have it. It's not just the people I've mentioned. Every single one of you has this indomitable spirit. But you've got to let it grow. You've got to realize that you as an individual make a difference, that you matter, that your life is here for a reason. And use it to help make the world a better place before it's too late. When I began Roots and Shoots, that was 91, the window was bigger. It's smaller now. And the window of time is getting smaller. But it's not too late if we get together. We must get together. And I want for the very last to say, it's not only humans who have an indomitable spirit. In Africa, in West Africa, in the Republic of Congo, is the largest chimpanzee sanctuary in Africa. It's for the chimpanzee orphans rescued from the illegal trafficking of wild animals around the world. Mothers are shot to steal their babies to sell overseas for circuses or entertainment. And okay, one tiny thing here that I forgot to say, my second visit to the Canary Islands was because at that time there was a big problem with the beach chimps, where people, they were very often smuggling drugs too, but they would have a little chimp dressed up, drugged, and we know they were drugged, and tourists would pay to hold them and get a photograph taken. And so with a little group of people, we came over to see what we could do, and it was stopped in the end. And the chimpanzees were mostly rescued and went to the to England, to a sanctuary there. And I believe there's somebody here tonight who was looking after the, who was helping in that operation to rescue these little chimps from the beaches of Spain. So I say that it's not only humans who have the indomitable spirit. And in this sanctuary, which is run by Spanish people in the Republic of Congo, there's about 160 chimpanzees there, many of them now full grown. One of them arrived as an infant, and she was very badly wounded. But thanks to the wonderful veterinarian, Rebecca Atencia, maybe some of you have met her because she comes to Spain quite often, and Rebecca managed to cure her. And then when she was 8 or 9, she got really, really sick. And again, Rebecca was able to cure her with a chimpanzee blood-to-blood transfusion. And Wunda had this fighting spirit, this indomitable spirit. She could have died twice, but she hung on to life. And finally, it was decided that she would be one of the candidates to go on to one of the beautiful islands given to us by the Congolese government. So I want to end with this little video of Wunda. Some of you may have seen the book, some of you may have seen the video, but it's just a perfect way to end a talk like this. This is a really exciting moment for me. The Jane Goodall Institute's Chimpunga Chimpanzee Rehabilitation Center in the Republic of Congo has for years been caring for infants whose mothers were killed, mostly for the illegal bushmeat trade. Many of them are now fully grown. Recently, we acquired 3 large forested islands on the beautiful Quilu River, where we can release many of the chimpanzees from our overcrowded center. In here is Wunda, and she nearly died, but thanks to Rebecca, she came back from the dead. And here she is, about to come out into this paradise. She's the 15th chimpanzee to get her freedom here. And we hope, ultimately, to have about 60 on the island. Today is the first time I've met Wunda. I talked to her on the boat, trying to reassure her. She must have wondered what was happening. None of us could predict exactly what she would do once the cage door opened. It was a very, very touching moment. One of the most amazing things that's ever happened to me. The warmth of her embrace is something I shall never forget. For Wunda and all the other chimpanzees we're working to bring here, Chinzula Island will provide a wonderful forest home where they will be cared for and safe. So now you've seen that, another reason for hope. Sanctuaries like Chimpunga, not only for chimpanzees and other animals in Africa, they're set up all over the world. And just this morning I released a turtle who came, who was rehabilitated in, whoever's translating, you know where I went yesterday to see where the turtles and seabirds are being rescued and cared for and released back in the wild. And the one we released today was called Goodall. That's Jane Goodall backwards. Goo from Goodall, Jar from Jane. Goodall was released back into the ocean. And there's even pictures of her taken underwater, swimming to freedom. What a lovely way for me to end my visit to Tenerife. Thank you all very much.
Doctora Jane Goodall se quiere despedir con una vocalización que hacen los chimpancés, que es un panhut. Y creo que lo mejor que podemos hacer para devolvérselo es hacerlo también una vez que termina ella, ¿vale?
Okay.
They will answer back with the same thing.
Okay. Well, then they must listen carefully, like. I forgot to thank the two people who were translating for the hard of hearing and